Right. Welcome everybody to the Rhinebeck Historical Society's annual holiday party here at the Rhinecliff Hotel. First thing I want to do is thank our host, James Chapman, for having us here every holiday season. It's wonderful that the Rhinecliff does this for us. And I want to thank my friend, Bill Nieves, for filming not only this, but the two short videos you're going to see after my talk. So about a year ago, I saw an article in Business Week magazine called Hop State New York, and it discussed the resurgence of beer growing, hops growing and beer making in New York State, and it pointed out that in the 1880s, New York State made 80% of the hops that were used for beer in America. I was quite intrigued by that. Oddly enough, for someone who doesn't drink beer, I decided to delve into the history of beer. So, whoops. Beer has been brewed for many, many years, and for thousands of years, alcoholic beverages have been around. And that's because in the Middle Ages, diseases like cholera and typhoid were rampant in European communities. So beer and wine, with their alcohol content, were the only safe liquids to drink. And many settlers, when they brought their brewing skills to America. Now, it's rumored, there's a lot of historians debating this, that when the pilgrims landed in Plymouth, they landed there because they ran out of beer, because they were supposed to go to Virginia. Now, not because the pilgrims were alcoholics, but because you could imagine what three-month-old water from a European well would have done to the crew of that ship. But historians say that's not true, because 50% of the settlers passed away in the first winter because of lack of food and shelter. So why would they do that? But my theory is the point of no return. The captain of that ship left a month or two after he dropped the pilgrims off, had to go back to Europe. He had to have half of the beer left so that he wouldn't die on the way back to Europe. So that's my theory. Nothing proved in fact, but that's my theory. So the settlers, once they got established, they did build a brewery. And they used corn because they didn't have barley or hops, so they used corn to make alcohol. And in 1642, Everett Van Stellen Pels, if I said that right, opened one of the first breweries in our area in Colony, New York. As more European colonists arrived, breweries popped up all over the state. And I have a couple to show you just in our area of taverns, some of which made their own beer, some of which imported beer from several local breweries. And here's a 1799 map, which shows, this is just north of town. This is the, whoops, I keep doing that. This is the,
sorry, Dave.
Maybe you better, are you doing that? Bone Steel's Tavern, Teeter's Inn, and Maul's Tavern. They're right next to the German Lutheran Church, which is, we know as Stone Church, just north of the 990 intersection. Now, Maul's Tavern, M-A-W-L-S, we know as Moule's Tavern. And this is what it looked like 100 years ago. This is behind the current mobile station at the 990 intersection. You know, there's right across from Ruby's. If there's a little road, a little section of Old Post Road, and if you go there, drive down there, you will see this today, because it looks like this today. And it looks pretty much the same. It hasn't changed that much in 100 years. It's now a private residence. It's no longer a tavern.
The bar was up on the second floor.
Thank you. So if we go to the next slide, you'll see this is from Howard Morse's book, which was produced in 1908. And it talks about the old hotel, the Revolutionary War stagecoach days. And here is the original Beekman Arms, supposedly from 1766, with a stagecoach pulling out. And that was another tavern. And across the street from where I live was the Bowie House Tavern. It was built in 1802. It was torn down in the mid-1900s. There is a plaque that talks about the Bowie House Tavern and the Yellowbird stagecoach that used to stop there on its way to Connecticut. Now there's one other tavern south of town, a couple of towns south of town. Here's the Kill and Crystal Lake, and there's Steenberg's Inn, Munford's Inn, and I have a picture of Steenberg's Tavern. It still is there today. It's right on Route 9 on your way towards Southlands, but it had a high fence and no place to park, and I didn't want to, you know, sort of break into these people's property to take a picture of what it looks like today, but it still is there if you drive by it. And just a couple more. This is Trapphagen on the Flats and Kip, both built taverns in Kipsbergen in Rhinecliff. They were the first taverns in the area. They were erected about 1709 near Long Dock. And if you look at the next slide, this is Kip's Tavern today. It's right out here on the road, on Rhinecliff Road. You can see it today. Someone's living in it, obviously. One last one is on Crum Elbow Road, right near St. Paul's Lutheran Church, was Marquardt's Inn. So you can see that in the 1700s, there were a lot of taverns. Some of them brewed their own beer, some of them bought beer locally. Now, they bought beer from this place, which was Vassar Brewery. Here's a picture of it. In 1801, James Vassar brewed ale and barley grown from seeds his brother Thomas brought from Norfolk, England. Demand was such that in 1801, James Vassar bought a farm between Mill and Main Streets in the village of Poughkeepsie. In 1811, a fire destroyed it, and in 1814, Matthew Vassar opened this brewery, and at the time, it was the largest brewery in the United States. So some people, local taverns, would have brought their beer from the Vassar Brewery. And in Albany, there was another brewery, Beverwick Brewery. I got this picture from Albany Institute of History and Art. And this is one of six breweries that were operating in Albany in 1660. So as soon as they got here, maybe not the first winter of the Pilgrims, but as soon as they got here, beer was very important. I'm sure that water was quite, you know, drinkable in Massachusetts and New York in the 1600s, but people loved their beer. And in the mid-1800s, following a mass immigration of Germans, most of the beer produced in the state was lager. And lager beer was critical because ice harvesting business was going strong, and it's a cold brewing process to make lager beer, and the ice harvesting was very important and enabled them to make the lager beer here. Here's a picture. This is the Petit Bistro, former cigar store, Linden's Lager Beer and Billiard Hall. That's what was in there when it first opened.
Awesome.
Before and these bricks here are the construction of the Rhinebeck Department Store. This is around 1870, after the Great Fire that destroyed the south side of East Market Street. Now, locally, you could buy beer or have it delivered to your home. Here's an ad from the 1912 Gazette Advertiser. Knickerbocker or Rupener. There are several reasons why. Jacob Rupert Brewery produces beer so good that there's none better at any price. The beer that's satisfied, delivered to your home by Walter Decker. Delivered free in the village. Jacob Rupert was a famous character. Here's a picture of his home. At Linwood, which unfortunately was, his ancestors donated this land to the Sisters of St. Ursula in Rhinecliff, just up the road here, and the mansion got torn down. But he owned the New York Yankees, and Jacob Rupert hired Babe Ruth to play for the Yankees. And later on, I think it's Jacob Rupert Jr., his son, that was responsible for Knickerbocker beer. And there was also a connection with the New York Knickerbockers.
Absolutely.
I believe he owned that as well as the son. So there's the old Ken that was on our flyer. Now, another local beer in New York, if you remember this, was Rheingold beer. Miss Rheingold, 1957. It's not a clear slide, but there was a contest. It was introduced by a German-American Liebman family in 1883. And in 1950 to 1960, it produced a third of the beer in New York State. And each year, they ran the Miss Rheingold pageant. And you guys probably remember that. And beer drinkers voted for the young lady who would serve on the beer can each year. And they said, it's quoted, that the selection of Miss Rheingold was as highly anticipated as the race for the White House. So we look at the next slide. You see, here's a ballot from 1953, and you voted for which one of these six young ladies you thought would be best on a beer can. So, throughout the early years in this country, there was always a battle. I sort of call it the beer wars. most citizens are very protective of their right to drink beer. And according to an 1888 article in the New York Times, the Literary Bureau of the New York Brewers, I have no idea what that is, but the Literary Bureau of the New York Brewers said that no man was a good citizen who didn't drink lager beer freely. The article went on to point out that it was unfair for the prohibitionist to walk around with red noses, handing out literature, demanding that the brewers be fined and imprisoned. Another 1895 article in the Times stated that German Americans opposed a doubling of the beer tax from $1 to $2 a barrel, claiming the article was food, and you don't tax food. Beer was, but.
Absolutely.
And it noted that if they voted for the tax increase, it would cause people to go for hard liquor instead of beer, because beer would be more expensive, and that would create a lot more problems, so they should keep the beer tax low. Now, in the 1880s, the Temperance Union began a long battle towards prohibition. In 1873, the Women's Christian Temperance Union was founded to create a sober and pure world, and it began a decades-long battle until prohibition happened. They fought to keep Sunday as the Sabbath, and stood outside of taverns praying and harassing customers. Rhinebeck had one that met above the current Village Pizza store. And below is a picture of some of the Temperance ladies. Lips that touch liquor shall not touch ours. That was one of their, they look very stern looking ladies there. She's pointing to the sign, but there's another one. You know, help me keep him pure, vote against the sale of liquors. So they finally succeeded. And in January 16th, 1920, until December 5th, 1933, prohibition. And I checked the Gazette Advertiser in our archives to see what was mentioned about prohibition in Rhinebeck when it became official in January 16th, 1920. So here's a picture of it, and it says, it's the day after January 17, 1920. It's unlawful to buy or sell a drink anywhere except for sacramental or medicinal purposes. Give a drink anywhere except in the home of the man who owns it. It says to carry a pocket flask. That's like a sacred right of Americans to carry a pocket flask. The interesting thing up here is to manufacture anything above 0.5% in your home. I'm going to talk about that in a minute. And several other things, you can't resupply it. Basically, once it's gone, and you can't give it as a present to anybody. So liquor was over. Now, I found this interesting thing in the 1927 Gazette. It's a beer ad for Rupert's Beer. Now, wait a minute, this is the middle of Prohibition. How is this possible? So I talked to Mike about it. And he said that the 18th Amendment did permit beverages up to 0.5%, which people said is pretty weak beer. Mike said that his father remembers that he called it near beer, and he said it wasn't very good. And so in 1927, this was actually near beer, or 0.5% beer. And Rheingold, I read, managed to survive by selling near beer and lemonade, which they made in their beer factories until Prohibition ended. Now, a lot of pressure built over the years for Prohibition to come to an end, and on December 5th, 1933, it did. And here is anti-Prohibition demonstration. Now, I don't know if these are the same women who were holding up those signs or not, but they want their beer. And so they're parading for beer. And so they were getting worried that speakeasies, you know, were rampant. No one had any respect for the law, and it created powerful criminal organizations that were, you know, Al Capone and all the mob that manufactured beer and sold it in the speakeasies. And if everyone was breaking the law, what law would they break next? So people were concerned about that. It was also the beginning of the Great Depression, and remember that dollar or $2 a barrel? States were losing a fortune in the beer taxes, so they wanted that. And of course, I guess Prohibition, I mean, the Depression made you want to drink. So, we look at this thing. I don't know where, if this is a real paper, the Roaring Good Times. Prohibition ends the last. And here they are all holding up their bottles of beer, quite happy. Now,
gentlemen, step out of your fedora.
Now, Brian Plum, who's here today, wrote the book on the history of the Beekman Arms, sent me a picture of the opening of the Beekman Arms bar in 1933 in Rhinebeck, because I couldn't find anything in the Gazette, November or December of 1933, mentioning that Prohibition ended. And this is probably why, because nobody visits the bar at the Beekman Arms when Prohibition ended. So I don't understand that. It was much quieter in Rhinebeck, and it wasn't even mentioned, as I said, in the Gazette. So, for the rest of the century, things returned to normal. Hops continued to prosper, but most beer was produced in large plants by Rheingold, Pabst, Miller, and others. When it started in the 21st century, what started me on this thing was the exponential growth of hops growing again and craft beer making all around the state. So, how is beer made? Beer is made from barley, water, hops, and yeast. And the basic idea is to take the sugars from the grain, usually barley, sometimes corn if you're a pilgrim, so that the yeast can turn it into alcohol and carbon dioxide, creating the beer, and hops is the preservative, and it also adds some unique flavor, which you'll learn about in a minute from the video. So getting back to hops, hops growing in the 1880s took place mostly around Cooperstown. And according to William Beardsley's article, when hops were king, that's the hop. They had to stabilize the agent and qualities to beer. Not only is beer improved by the hops, but the distinctive aroma and bitterness, it allows the beer to be stored for a very long time. This is the key to the whole thing. And 40,000 acres were in growing hops in New York in 1850. So it was a really big thing here. Here's a picture from 1937 of a hops barn in Otsego County. Now I gave I wrote an article about tobacco and tobacco barns, and there were big open air barns where the tobacco could dry, and the hops were hung up and dried the same way in these hops barns. Now at the turn of the 20th century, the hops began its long decline. There was downy mildew and aphids that killed the hops crop. And of course, 13 years of prohibition effectively eliminated the hops farmers in New York State. And now the resurgence has happened because you can grow 1,000 pounds an acre, and you can get, so you can make $20,000 an acre on hops, whereas you get about $6,000 an acre for corn. So hops farming is really growing. And in the past 5 years, according to Business Week, hops farming has grown from 15 to 250 acres, and that was last year. It's probably 500 acres by now. And breweries, custom craft breweries, from 40 to 105 in the past 5 years, and they're opening all the time. So here's a quick picture of hops growing in a hops field. They're very cute. They look like little pine cones, and they're growing on the vine, which is what they're called. And the last slide is there's some hops in my hand, so you can see how big they are. So I wanted to sort of finish off by saying, so how do you grow hops and how do you make beer? So Bill and I took a trip to Eastern View Nurseries, home of Duchess Hops in LaGrangeville, and Carmine Istvan gave us a tour of the vineyard, he calls it. And then Bill and I went to the new brewery at the CIA, and we met with Hutch Kugelman, who's the head brewer there, and he gave us a tour of the brewery and told us how beer is made. So. And then there's one more thing that happened yesterday. From the ground brewery in Red Hook is growing barley and converts barley into malt, the third part of this process. And he's coming in a little while to show you how barley is converted into malt. So I have two 10-minute videos to show you, and let's get started.
from the Rhinebeck Historical Society.
Carmine, it's been a pleasure to meet you.
Yeah, Burry, it's wonderful to be here today.
Thank you.
We are here at Eastern View Nurseries, home of Duchess Hops.
Yes.
And we're going to take a little tour of the farm and see how hops are grown and learn a little bit about it.
What intrigued me about growing the hops is the history, bringing hops back, bringing that that farm to table kind of experience back. But in my experience, I always say, you know, farm to pint, just to put my little twist on it, or like my shirt says, you know, no farms, no beer. You know, we have to be creative, just to be creative for the agritourism, because about Hudson Valley and what we do is, we want to bring people to the farm, come and take a tour of the vineyard and see what it's all about. And, you know, maybe give them a taste of some fresh local beer that's made with our hops. So just a little history. When sailors came across seas, they used to have water and beer on their boats. Well, after a couple months, guess what? Their beer would stay fresh, but their water spoiled. Why? What happened? Well, when they got right past India, they knew that their water would spoil, and that's why they called them the drunken sailors, because they had beer. Beer stayed fresh because they had hops. Hops preserve the beer, the water, because its agent preserves. So that's where hops came in with the beer, and that's why you got Indian Pale Ale. IPA beer is because when they passed India, IPA, Indian Pale Ale, that's where the hops in the water, in the beer, preserve the beer. Little history about Dutchess County. We had a couple farms. We're in LaGrangeville. We had a couple farms right down the road here in LaGrange that actually grew hops. And when they grew the hops, about 1890s, Matthew Vassar, Vassar College, everybody knows Matthew Vassar Brewing Company, Matthew Vassar made his money off of beer. Poughkeepsie and the area, actually, the area was developed because of the beers, and he bought local. Roosevelt, when the Prohibition was expelled, it was Roosevelt from Dutchess County, who was the president, and the history of Dutchess County with Roosevelt and Prohibition and where everything came with the hops, I thought it was a good opportunity to start growing hops and for the agri-market.
So when did you get into the hops growing business?
Well, we did about 5 years ago. Dutchess Hops, we saw a need for local hops. The history of hops is tremendous, and we knew that we had something that was once our number one commodity here in New York State. We knew that if we grow the hops, that they will come.
Yeah. And are they more profitable than other crops?
Absolutely. They are. They're very profitable. All of our crop that you see that's grown right here is already sold, pre-sold for the year.
Wow.
It just like anything. Farming is a lot of work, and it's very labor intensive.
How many varieties of hops do you grow, and what is the difference between the varieties?
We have actually 9 varieties here. Some varieties have done better than others. If you pan across the field when you get an opportunity, you'll see some of them are larger than others. Some of them have not grown as well. Well, we did a lot of testing to see what would do well, and we looked at history of New York to see what did do good in the area. But anything we tried by trial and error. And we have 9 varieties, but we have Cascade, Centennial, Newport, Tea Maker, which is made used for teas. Hops are very good for tea. And also we have actually a hop coffee that we have a local roaster that actually makes a coffee, which is really interesting and good to drink. So what's the difference between the hops? Some will for bittering. Some of them have a fruity taste. Some of them have a citrusy taste. Some of them even have like a gingery taste. So depending on the hop and the type of beer you're brewing is when you add that variety of hop. its alpha acids and its acidity will differ from each type of hop. Very similar to the grapes. Grapes, you have different types of grapes, and depending if you're growing a hop here in the Northeast or if you're growing that same Cascade hop in the West Coast, it's going to taste different because our soil is different.
So are they difficult to grow, like, you know, water, nutrients, insects?
Just like any farming, we have an irrigation system here, and the better you irrigate it, the better you'll do. So yes, we need water. Water is very beneficial. We have an average of, you know, I think maybe like 30 inches of rain in the Northeast or in our area, give or take a little bit. Hops would like to have about 42, 43 inches. So we supplement.
Okay, and how many plants and acres do you have here?
About 4 acres here growing. Just over 3,000 binds. It's a bind with a B. Hops grow on a bind, where grapes grow on a vine. Same concept, but they're called binds. So welcome to the vineyard.
Annual that they grow these vines, or like grapes, sometimes are on the fence, they're wired to it, and they stay that way. Do these grow up this distance each year?
Yes, every year. If we look at this particular one, and this is actually a centennial hop, and this will grow. This one's probably about 13 feet tall right now. This will grow, and then at the end of the season, what we'll do is we'll cut the top, and we'll cut it all the way down the bottom. And then when we cut it down all at the bottom, we'll harvest it. Then every year they come back, so it's a perennial.
But you cut into the ground.
Cut them right to the ground like there's nothing there.
Huh, interesting.
And I mentioned you had a question, pests. Yes, there is pests. Aphids, downy mildew is another issue. And we've noticed that they don't really show in the books or history. Was the Japanese beetles have been a very big pest, something they really didn't have in the past, but now we're showing that Japanese beetles have really done a number on the leaves of our hop plants.
Because I read just before Prohibition, the downy mildew hit the crops in New York State, and that was the beginning of the decline, and then of course 13 years of nobody buying any hops put all the hops farmers out of business at that point.
Yes, what we do is we work with Cornell Cooperative Extension. All these plants that were planted almost 5 years ago are the Cornell disease resistant. They were actually put through test, but we still saw some evidence of some downy mildew here and there. So we just got to keep an eye on it.
So when you harvest them, you cut them to the ground, you pull the hops off, and then how do you prepare them? I saw some old photos of like hops drying barns. 100 years ago, how do you dry them or prepare them for the brewery?
Well, what we do is we try to sell most of them wet. That means picked right off the bind and immediately within 24 hours in the brewer's pots, stirring it up for fresh, wet hop beer.
Huh.
Now, if the brewery does not want it and they want it dried, if you hear the fans that we had on over there, oh, it's called our Oast House. And what we do is we dry the hops and we take the moisture content out of it. And then we put it in bags, a half pound bags, and then we send them out to the brewery.
So I've read that there's malt and barley. There are a lot of barley fields in Rhinebeck. I saw that people are growing it up in Red Hook. But is this the most expensive ingredient of?
Yes. I believe that the hops is probably one of the most expensive ingredients.
So growing hops is more profitable than barley or other crops? Then it's a big
business. If you're educated and understand farming, hops is actually a good crop to grow. But if you don't understand it and if you don't learn about it, just like educating yourself, you're in for a big surprise because it's very labor intensive.
It looks, well, I'm very impressed. This looks really nice. And I want to thank you for...
Absolutely, and one thing I want you to end with, which is very important, you asked me the biggest question was, what do hops do? Well, hops actually, like I said, the bittering, the tasting, the aroma. What I would like to do with you right now is so you can, I'm a person who likes to see it, smell it, and I think we should smell some fresh hops, what it smells like fresh off the vine. So if we want to go to maybe these guys are ready right behind us. And if we take a look, and you and I will grab a couple of these hops right here. I want you to grab that one. I'm going to give you two. Grab that right there. And I'm going to grab these two. And you and I, what we're going to do is we're going to grab these. Look at these. And we're going to squish them in our hands like this. Real good. Real good. Real good. Real good. Now smell those hops. You smell that?
Oh, wow. Nice.
You smell the citrusy?
Yes, it does.
Like that?
It's a real...
Now, take this out of your hand. Now feel the stickiness in your hand.
Oh,
those
yeah.
are the oils. Those are the oils. Oh. Hops.
These are nice.
As, you know, everybody thinks the typical beer drinker. As somebody with a pot belly and unhealthy. Well, actually, hops has antioxidants that are so... Hoppier the beer, the better it's for your health. And it's actually proven that hops are more beneficial in beer than grapes are in wine. So, like I would say, no farms, no beer. And September 10th at our farm, we are having a farm to pint experience for everybody to enjoy our local hops.
We do it every year.
Every year. September 10th. Next year is going to be September 9th, 2017.
Great. Well, thank you so much for... explaining hops to us. This will be great.
Absolutely.
Good. Thank you.
Yes, thank you.
Okay, we're here today at the Culinary Institute in Hyde Park with the head brewer of the new brewery mm-hmm. in the Culinary Institute.
Mm-hmm.
And we're here to find out how beer is made.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. Welcome to the brewery at the CIA.
So how did you get into beer and brewing beer?
I actually was a middle school teacher and I used to homebrew for fun. And over time I figured out that I really didn't like middle school teaching all that much, but I really like brewing beer. So I started homebrewing more, and then I moved out to the Northwest. When I was out in the Northwest, I got into great craft beer, and eventually figured out that that was an actual job, that you could be hired to go brew beer. So I saw it out in the paper, went interviewed for a job that I didn't get. In retrospect, I wasn't qualified for it, but I hit it off with the brewer. So when he had a job that was available, he contacted me, and I went to work, and from there, worked my way up the ladder. So I've been brewing professionally for about 14 years.
So how long have you been here at the CIA?
We just opened this brewery in October, so I just came on board the CIA in October. So this is our brewery that we built in partnership with Brooklyn Brewing Company.
And so you make the beer that is served in the various restaurants?
Yep, we have beer on here on tap here at the Egg, which is our student commons, and all four of the restaurants. And then this also functions as a classroom. So we have a class, a brand new class, called the Art and Science of Brewing, where the bachelor's level culinary students can learn more about the brewing process and then take that knowledge out into the culinary world with them. So they get to 2 days a week of classroom instruction with Professor Doug Miller, who's one of our beverage professors, food and beverage professors. And then this serves as the lab. They come in here and work with me and get their hands dirty and help me brew beer.
Well, in Rhinebeck, mm-hmm. we're growing hops mm-hmm. on Route 308. We're growing barley on Route
oh, yeah.
9, across from Hobson's.
Okay.
That's a big field there of barley. So what I came here to find out is, after I've interviewed the farmer who's
sure.
growing hops in Rhinebeck, what happens, what do you do with the hops, what do you do with the barley, how do you make beer,
sure.
and what are the various, there are different, there's ales and stouts and lagers,
yep.
and different flavors of beer, and how is that all done?
Sure.
Was what I
so
wanted
yeah,
to
for,
today.
Four major ingredients in beer, which two of which you mentioned, malted barley and hops. Also water and yeast to be the other two important ones. And when the barley is grown by the farmer, it then has to go through a
process
called malting. It should be about 6% alcohol. And that's done by a maltster. There is a local maltster in Germantown, although the New York malting industry is kind of in its infancy a little bit. We're great at growing barley, but we're just learning how to malt it properly. Malting basically means that they take the grain, soak it in water, and allow it to begin to germinate. What that does is it kind of almost fools the grain into thinking that it's time to grow. So it begins to sprout. That breaks down a lot of the interior carbohydrates in the grain into a simpler form. And then the malt gets kilned. And depending on how long they kiln it, you can get different colors and flavors that come out of the grain. So I'm buying malt. I'm buying malted barley. That malted barley then gets cracked open in a mill to expose the insides. And then we go through a process called mashing. Mashing means we take that malted barley and we mix it up with hot water at a really specific temperature, usually in the high 140s to low 150s Fahrenheit. What that does is going to activate enzymes in the grain, and those enzymes are going to take the starch in the grain, break them down into sugar. So the whole goal of mashing is to extract as much sugar from the grain as possible. And then that grain's also going to give you your color for the beer, as well as a lot of the body and a lot of the flavors, depending on what kind of beers. You mentioned stouts. Stouts are a beer that feature a lot of roasted malt flavors. So then we're going to take that liquid, we're going to separate it out from the grain. That liquid's called wort. It's kind of unfermented beer. We're going to boil it, and that's when we add in the hops. And hops are flowers, like you mentioned. They grow on the big, tall poles, big, tall vines. And they're sort of cone-shaped flowers. And hops provide a lot of the bitterness to beer to balance the sugar from the grain. If you didn't use any hops, the beer would be very sweet, cloyingly sweet. So the hops can provide a lot of bitterness. They also can provide a lot of flavor and aromatics, depending on what kind of beer you want to make. So something like a stout might not be a very hoppy beer. It might be mostly the malty flavors. But something like a pale ale or an IPA, it's going to be the opposite. The malt is going to be the backbone of the beer, but the hops are going to be what you're mostly tasting and smelling. So it's a little bit, you can determine what, depending on what type of hops you buy, because there are lots of different varieties. And when you add them into the boil, you can determine how much bitterness you get out of them or how much flavor and aroma you get out of them.
Complex.
So, yeah,
it's pretty tricky.
You know, there's a lot of parallels to cooking. And this is all just to make the wort. This is before we actually even turn it into beer.
No, I've not. I've baked bread for many, many years.
Okay.
And when I'm fermenting my yeast and is this dough ready, you smell the dough and it smells like beer.
Yes. Yeah, that's the smell of fermentation. You're smelling the alcohol being created, really. But so then you get to the next part, fermentation. So once we've mashed in the grains, separated out the wort, boiled it, added our hops, then we're going to chill it down and then we're ready to ferment. So we're going to transfer it into one of our fermentation tanks and add our yeast. And yeast is single-celled organism that everybody remembers from high school biology. It just wants to grow and split in two. It eats the sugar that we broke down from the grain and produces alcohol and carbon dioxide, as well as some flavor compounds during fermentation. And for ales, which is mostly what we brew here, you're looking at about a 15 to 20 day fermentation cycle. So two and a half weeks in that range. Yeast is going to eat all that sugar and produce a lot of alcohol and CO2 and heat, so you have to keep the temperature under control. Usually primary fermentation, where the yeast is doing all its work, takes about 5-6 days, 4 days in that range. You're going to let it mellow out, and then you're going to let the beer mature. And that you can usually be done either at mid temperatures or cold temperatures, usually around 35, but it can be a little bit warmer too, depending on the type of aging you want to do. And you're going to let it sit and mellow out cold. So after 7 days, alcohol is there, the flavor is very raw. So the extended aging time cold is what's going to give it more maturity and more of a mellow flavor that's balanced. So after, say, a week cold, or a week warm, week cold, or 10 days cold, then you're ready to finish the beer off. So you'll take it out of the fermentation tank, you'll filter it if you want to have clear beer, and then carbonate, add CO2 to the beer, and then it's ready for service.
So this is a lot quicker than wine that takes years to age.
Yes. And one of the main differences between brewing and wine has to do with the ingredients. Obviously, you're using different stuff, but with wine, if you don't have good grapes, you're not getting good wine. Doesn't matter how skilled you are, how nice your equipment is, or anything. If the grapes are bad, the wine's going to be bad. With brewing, it's more about the process and about paying attention and how the fermentation goes. And winemakers are concerned with cleanliness, but it's not the be-all, end-all, whereas sanitation in a brewery is everything. From the time you boil the wort until it gets to your pint glass, everything has to be sanitary. Because even after fermentation, beer is full of sugar, and it's great, and it's cold, and it's a great place to grow things. There's nothing that can grow in beer that can hurt you, because the pH is very low, but there are things that will make it taste bad, will spoil it. So, so you're looking at about, like I said, for ales, about a two and a half to 3 week fermentation time. We do occasionally do some lager beers, right? So in general, lagers are a longer fermenting process, a different type of yeast, and instead of being done around room temperature, around 65 or 70, lagers ferment around 45 or 50 degrees. So it's colder, it's slower, and it's more like a 30, really a 45 to 60 day fermentation time. So it's a much longer process. It's one of the reasons you don't see a lot of small breweries making lagers, because each lager takes up, you know, holds up the tank for much, much longer. You're able to make a lot more ale in that same time. So it's almost a business decision as much as anything. From a flavor perspective, as a broad generalization, you can say that ales tend to be a little bit more complex flavored. They have a little bit more fruity notes, so you get more esters, which are these chemical compounds that are being produced by the yeast during fermentation that happen to smell and taste like fruit and spice flavors. And they can, they're usually very subtle, but they can be very dominant in some, especially Belgian style ales. Lagers in general tend to be kind of cleaner and crisper and have a, you know, a nice clean finish. They don't have as many of those estery, fruity flavors in them. And that's a really broad generalization, but that's sort of how you could divide the two families of beer. Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah.
So I guess now what I'd like to know is what all the various tanks in this room do in the process of making the beer.
Over my shoulder here, that's actually the brew house, which is where we actually are producing beer and breaking down the raw ingredients. So you'll see the grist case, which holds our milled grain, the mash tun, where we mix the grain with hot water and soak it and allow the starch to break down into sugar. Directly across from that is the lauter tun. That's for actually separating the wort out from the grain. So that liquid, that's where we're going to leave the grain behind. That liquid, that wort, then gets transferred to the brew kettle where we're going to boil it, and that's when the hops get added in. And then the fermentation tanks are where we're going to then transfer it and ferment it. So the brew is all one day, that breaking down the ingredients and getting into the fermentation tanks. And the fermenters is where we're going to ferment it, add the yeast, and that's where it's going to become beer. And that's where it's going to stay for those 14 to 20 days.
And it's chilled?
It's not chilled. For ales, we're going to ferment it around 65 or 70, and the yeast produces a lot of heat, right, as it eats the sugar. So there, yeah, there's cooling jackets on the tanks. So we're actually able to use a food grade coolant, which doesn't come in contact. It's on the outside of the tank, and that allows us to keep it under control, basically to monitor that heat. We want to keep that heat at a really specific temperature. The hotter the beer gets, the more it produces weird flavors. So we don't want to do that. And then we have our bright beer tank, and bright beer just refers to nice, shiny, filtered beer, nice and clear, that you can, you know, kind of shines at you. And that's where we're going to carbonate it. So depending on the day you come in here, we might have different beers in the tanks. We have three fermenters. We can have up to three beers that are actively fermenting at once. Right now we've got a batch of our IPA in tank number three, a batch of our wit in tank number two, and those are our two main house beers. And then in tank one is actually a student project. So every class of our students gets a chance to choose a style of beer to make and help me create it. So that's a Maibach. That's actually a lager. That's been in there for about 40 days.
How many gallons are in those tanks?
About 220. We have a 7-barrel system. Everything in the brewery is measured in U.S. barrels, which is 31 gallons. Kind of a random, so it's kind of a leftover from old measurements of, you know, putting things into wooden casks. So this is a 7-barrel system. A barrel is 31 gallons. Most people are familiar with kegs, half kegs. Well, those are 15.5.
So how do you get the beer to the public? Is there a put them in kegs?
Yes.
In a bottling system?
Or? No, from the bright beer tank, we'll put it into kegs.
And then the kegs are what they'll serve it from?
Yeah, and we use a smaller keg, which are more portable, and they also fit under our bars in the restaurants better.
So you're not bottling and selling
beer?
You're
nope. Just we have beer on tap here at the Egg, and you can buy growlers, the half-gallon jugs that we can fill from the tap. You can buy those to go, but we don't have bottles. And most breweries this size wouldn't. Bottling only makes financial sense when you get to a certain size.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Well, good. This is a very exciting.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun here. The students add a lot of creativity and interest to the project.
So you're not serving any local restaurants yet?
No, by law, we actually can't.
Oh, so you're just at the school?
Yeah. One of the things people don't necessarily think about when it comes to production of an alcoholic beverage is that there's a lot of legalities that go into
state liquor license to sell elsewhere, but you can make it at home.
It's
this is home.
Every state's different, and there's federal involved as well. But in New York State, you cannot have a production facility and also have multiple independent liquor licenses for restaurants. And we have four restaurants here on campus, so we are allowed to brew beer for our own restaurants, but we can't sell it off campus. So if you want to try our beer, you got to come to the CIA and have some here in the park.
I plan on doing.
Yeah, please.
Well, I think you've answered all my questions.
Oh, okay,
it's very
great.
Exciting coming, and today I want to thank you for inviting us to come and film it.
Yeah.
And I'll get, when I finish everything at the end of the year, I'll get you a copy of the,
that would be great,
the final product.
Yeah, that would be great.
My final product.
Yeah, sure.
And thank you.
Hey, thank you for coming in.
Thank you.
All right, the last part of our talk tonight is the missing link. We talked about hops, we talked how you make beer, but barley is the other ingredient, which is converted into malt. So today, we have people from Dennis Nessel from the Ground Brewery in Red Hook.
And he's Hi, everybody. My name is Dennis Nessel, and I'm from Hudson Valley Malt, and I'm standing next to Ken Migliarelli. He is the farmer. He grows barley, he grows tomatoes, he grows a lot of things. But tonight we're talking about beer. I wasn't here for the wonderful presentation, but being that you're the Historical Society, here's one great little tidbit of history. This beer, is from the Ground Brewery, which is on Ken's farm in Red Hook, okay? This beer is the first beer where the grain was grown here in the Hudson Valley, which is malt. The hops were grown here. The water came from here, the yeast came from here. This is the first beer that's been grown here, malted here, brewed here, and tonight you're going to get a chance to enjoy it in the Hudson Valley since Prohibition. Isn't that cool? So I figured I would start with that. I call it the Green Tractor. This is an American Pale Ale, and this is definitely historic. So basically what I was telling Dave was what we do at Hudson Valley Malt is we take the grain that the farmer grew, because you can't make beer and whiskey out of the raw grain from the field, okay? The grain itself from the field is protein, it's starch, and it's an embryo, and it's dormant, it's asleep. What we do at Hudson Valley Malt is we trick that grain into thinking it's springtime. So in our malt house, it's cool and it's moist, and we germinate the seed. So when the seed takes on water, its DNA says, I've got to sprout. So it sprouts, and we control its growth. And what happens when we control its growth is the protein that is in the seed, that when it comes from Ken, the protein gets broken down into a very important thing that the brewers need. They need enzyme, because the enzyme eats the starch and creates sugar. Because if this was sugar in the field, I'm thinking that Ken's field, that everybody be in the field grabbing barley and eating it, because it would be sweet. So the bottom line is the brewer needs sugar, because yeast eats the sugar and creates alcohol that makes us all happy, right? So I digress. Let me go back. Oh, wait. So if I talk about enzymes, the bottom line is the brewer needs enzymes. So that's what a malt house. Our sole job is to take the grain from the farmer and turn that grain into something that can eat up so that the make fermentable sugars. We have to coax the sugar out of it. So I want to pass this around. Jeanette, could you take this to folks? This is malt. And so chew on it. It's a cereal grain. Chew on that. And then Jeanette also has hops, which we grow. I'm going to pass this around. You can take the hop and just run it through your fingers and just smell that wonderful stuff.
Let it sit in
your mouth
for a little.
I want to pass this around too. This is what barley looks like. So basically what we do at Hudson Valley Malt is take Ken's grain, we turn it into malt so we can make beer. The historic thing, what's going on in our state right now, it's a wonderful time because craft beer is now being made here. New York State craft beer legislation came in 2012. So now we've got brewers all around that are making beer.
Yeah.
And so Ken has a brewery right on his farm. And Ken, just tell him a little story about kind of what got you and I going.
Well, probably for the last 10 or 15 years, you know, we grow a lot of vegetables, about 350 acres of vegetables, about 100 acres of mixed fruit. So to replenish the soil, because we don't have a lot of animal production going on, to put manures back into the soil to replenish them, I take fields out of production, and I work with about three or four different cover crops. They call it green manure. So I use sorghum, sudan, sometimes I use oats, sometimes clovers and legumes. And I kind of leave, we're basically growing vegetables for 2 years, and then I try to go into grain or hay for like 3 to 4 years to get into a nice rotation to replenish the soil. And for many years, I didn't get a return on those years that I took the land out of production and had it fallow to replenish. And about 5 years ago, Remarket down in New York City passed a rule that 15% of the flour that the bakers were using had to be sourced from locally grown wheat. So I started growing wheat, and I thought it was going to be easy, except there's a thing called vomitoxin, which you have to have the grain tested, and it has to fall under the 1.0 vomitoxin for human consumption in baking and brewing. I could not get the wheat below 1.0 after 3 years of growing it, so it was very frustrating. But 3 years ago, I started growing barley, and the wheat, even though I had the wheat, even though it wasn't good for human consumption, I sold it for animal feed, you know, chicken feed, so I was able to get some return, but not as much as if I was going to sell it to a baker. 3 years ago, I started with barley, and that falls under the same criteria where it has to fall under the 1.0. My first year growing barley, I was able to get it under 1.0, and I met with Dennis before that, and he was just dabbling with growing some barley and malting it. And I sat down with him and his wife, and you know, he's a finance guy. He works for Merrill Lynch, and his wife works for another big outfit in marketing. And I basically told them that one of them need to quit their job and get into the malting business. Because my thing is, for a few years I was going to up to UVM up in Vermont to a grain conference. And the big thing is, once you grow this barley, now it has to be malted. And I would have to travel like 100 miles or so to a malt house to get it malted. So Dennis and Jeanette took the bite, and they started a malt house. They have a 20C on the agri markets. It's, you know, they have to get inspected, and he can malt about 2 to 3 tons a week, which is, and I'm looking to do like 100, 150 tons of barley a year, and you know, 50 weeks, 2 tons, you know, 3 tons a week. So it's nice.
You can make a lot of beer.
Yeah. So now it's nice that you know, the barley's growing, you know, in Red Hook, and it goes about 2.5 miles or so up to Dennis's malt house, gets malted, comes back to the farm. We have a brewmaster on the farm. It's getting brewed, and so the whole process happens within a few miles, and it's a nice connection, and it hasn't been done, like you said, since like Prohibition, so it's kind of cutting edge, and it's a nice return.
So what we're passing out right now, that beer, ladies and gentlemen, is the first beer that beer was grown by Ken. So this is the farmer that grew that beer. So what's great is it's happening here. Now remember, this hasn't been done in 100 years. This crop, Ken takes the risks. Ken goes out there and he fights the weather, and he's out there planting, he's out there fertilizing, he's out there harvesting. He takes the risk on this. This crop here, as you heard him say, he's been doing it for 3 years. Before that, barley hasn't been grown here for 100 years. So you're tasting that beer. So I hope you enjoy it. And when you drive down the road and you see these beautiful fields, you see all this wonderful stuff, please support local craft beer. Because when you do that, you're supporting local agriculture. You're supporting the farmer. Because if it wasn't the farmer's fields and the farmer's not successful, you'll see condos. Right?
No, not anymore. We got the land on conservation easement.
Enjoy the beer. Thanks for having us. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming, and everyone have a wonderful, happy holiday.